Thanks a lot for joining. As I mentioned, we've got a packed couple of hours where we want to cover Agile and Scrum for our newly forming IDM team. You can see the agenda that I put up here. Just in brief, we want to cover the general principles of Scrum and Agile, go over the various ceremonies that we go through on a regular basis, the recurring meetings, touch upon the Scrum team and the respective members and their roles, and then go through kind of the framework of how data is assembled and stored within the framework, and then the general fundamentals of Rally. Hopefully we'll be able to cover that as well.
Yes.
I know that those are a lot of the key questions that we've had over the past couple of meetings since we've gotten started. And then hopefully we'll have time at the end for Q&A.
Yes.
So Ravi, as I mentioned to you, this is the identity management team, newly forming. We've got some very experienced, skilled engineers and architects on the team, but kind of new to Agile and Scrum.
Yeah.
So I've asked Ravi to join. Ravi is an expert within Cisco and industry-wide on Agile and Scrum. So I thought it would be a great opportunity for him to share his expertise as we get going here.
Absolutely.
So Ravi, you can introduce yourself. I'll also pass the ball on to you. We can dive into this.
Yeah.
Christina and I will keep an eye on time to make sure that we're able to cover things within
absolutely.
A couple hours.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
All right. So thank you. And you want me to start sharing?
Yeah, passing the ball.
Okay. All right. Can you see my page here, all of you?
Yeah.
Perfect.
Very clear.
All right. So you can see a logo here, and I was part of this central engineering team for 2 years as CDO, Cisco Development Organization wide Agile Coach. And at that time, between 2010 to 2013, almost 2.5, 3 years, I was Cisco's only full-time Agile Coach. I used to do a lot of coaching engagements with BUs like CIS, BU here, and I would learn, have some successes, have some failures, learn from those failures, and create a community. And one way to create community was writing on IV community like this. And also, I created three conferences for internal Cisco. There is also a CEC page for CPDM Standard Agile. So I was essentially part of that. I spent an year and a half with PayPal, primarily as a Scrum Kanban coach, and got some really good experience on Kanban and Scrumban, coaching about 28 teams there over 1.5 years. And so now, with my Cisco experience on Scrum and my PayPal experience on Kanban, I think I'm almost becoming complete, but there is a lot to learn, I can tell you. And the best way to learn is to learn from each other. So one of the tenets of Scrum process is that we swarm on work. Unlike waterfall, we don't really box ourselves into job titles and roles and say that this is Ravi's work and this is Derek's work and Klaus there is going to only do architecting and nothing else. In Scrum process.
No. That is true, actually. sorry, could not resist.
No, absolutely. So I want this to be as interactive as it can be. A lot of my training experience has been training from the back of the room. This is a technique that a lot of experienced coaches use. There's not much slideware. There is a lot of references like this page that you're seeing that I'll be giving URLs to later on. And so it is going to be experiential learning. So after covering some of the basic building blocks based on the agenda that Derek came up with, we will get into this Q&A session. And feel free to stop me anytime you like. Can we start now? Perfect. So can you see this deck, the slide slide that I'm sharing. This has about 40 slides, of which I'm going to cover only 20 today. The reason is this is all-encompassing deck. It is a deck that we created collectively as Cisco coaches. Internal coaches network helped me create this deck that we used for internal conference, pre-conference tutorial workshops. So we would have 4-hour team workshops and 4-hour management exec leadership workshops on Agile Lean. And this was a common deck that we created across the board. So on the wiki page I was showing early on, I have shared this deck. So you will get everything. So one of the important things that I always quote before starting presentations like these is a quotable quote from Eisenhower. How many of you are familiar with that quote, which is at the end of the slide here? Plans themselves are useless, but the planning process is indispensable. Most of you must have come across this quote. All right. So we are used to doing a lot of planning, aren't we? We are Cisco. We are used to working on large programs and product lines and initiatives, and we plan a lot. We spent 3 days doing release planning, didn't we, last month?
Yep.
And are we sure that those plans that we created are rock solid, that will be never-changing plans? So you know what? Over last almost a century, ever since this quote came up, world has realized that too much planning upfront is not really useful, that the plans themselves keep changing. The word useless should be read as changing. Plans are changing, but planning process is very vital, very important. That's because people come together, collaborate. What one person can do, when 10 people come together and do that, there is a lot of difference between those two. So with that, I have this training alliance that I want to form with you. As coach trainer, we create an alliance at the beginning of any training workshop like this. An alliance would mean that this is the set of topics that we will most likely discuss, and do we agree on something like this? That is the point about having alliance. Now, I do not use builds in PowerPoint, not much. I use innovative ideas. This particular idea that you're looking at is an idea called product tree. And if you Google innovationgames.com or innovation games, this is one of the innovation games that product and engineering management in most companies uses to ideate, to discover things. So you can see that some of these topics are going to be low-hanging fruits on this tree. And some of the topics are going to be topics on canopy of the tree, long pole items that we may or may not get to. But this is something that I would like to go through. I will try to align with the agenda that Derek came up with so that we will most likely focus on this part of the tree, which is Agile and Lean basics. A lot of the remainder will be self-paced learning, and see, we'll see how this goes. The important part of this product tree is that it has roots that are based on 5 agile values. So anytime you look at any process framework, a process framework has key values, process framework has key principles, and there is typically a manifesto that drives these values and principles. I always like to start at values because the value system is very, very key, is very much a key factor. We are used to value systems in corporates. At Cisco, we have this VACMs and stuff like that. So you're familiar with value system in general. So when it comes to Agile Scrum, there are these 5 values. there is a value called focus. And the focus is exhibited by having a sprint backlog that the team commits to for a time box. And that's the part. So focus and commitment go hand in hand. There's a focus that in this 2 weeks or 3 weeks, we are going to work on this and hopefully only this. And that creates that commitment. The respect part of it is actually something that Agile borrowed from Lean. This is more like respecting each other as human beings, collaborators, and that's about that. Openness is a very critical fact. There are ceremonies in Scrum process that require this openness. An important ceremony which contributes to something called inspect and adapt, a ceremony called retrospective. You are familiar with the PPM process in Cisco's waterfall. Some of you might have heard about that, postmortem analysis. And that also kind of indicates this. So the point about being open is that with an agreement to be confident, agreement about confidentiality, that this openness is restricted to the team and it will not go out of the room. It's more like the Las Vegas factor. What is here in the room stays in the room. It is that openness that you want to have in Scrum teams. That there's no back talking, there's no rebuttal, there's straight talk. And that requires courage. You want to be courageous, to be open about things. And so as such, these are the five values. This value system is very, very, very much the roots of this product tree that I'm presenting to you in form of Agile Lean training here. So we'll have this agenda, and you can see that there are about 8 topics here. We will start with manifesto. We'll do an overview of a compare and contrast between Agile and Lean, looking at principles really, and then coming to definitions of Agile and Lean. And then, I'm trying to find my mouse cursor here. Yes. And then talking about the whys, not necessarily the 5 whys, but essentially what is the rationale behind choosing an Agile or Lean process framework. And then we get into a little bit of a depth in terms of what is Agile, why Agile, and then what is Lean, why is Lean. And then there are a couple of things that I want to touch upon, which is changing role of manager in Agile. And then also the changing role of team member in Agile. That we need a lot of specializing generalists in Agile to make it work. So we'll touch on those two aspects. So this very closely maps to the basics. What this does not cover is the rally team tasking stuff that we will allude to towards the end. And I hope to time box this within the time that we have here.
Starting, I think we had about 15 minutes for the principles.
Yes.
All right. But we're a few minutes behind, so maybe we can zoom through the principles and jump into the ceremonies right after that.
Yeah, absolutely. So the essential part of this is that in 2001, few folks came together, and there's a picture from that. Those of you already know about this is that there are a lot of well-known people here who created this manifesto, and their point was that we are doing extreme programming right now, but let's go step back and see why we are doing this kind of collaboration-based programming. And they came up with these 4 ideas that, yeah, processes and tools are important, but we should give more importance to individuals and interactions. The individuality still matters because that's the skill that you bring to the team, to the table. And the interaction between amongst these high-skilled individuals is really what creates the product. And that's the next manifesto item, working software over comprehensive documentation. We do too much management reporting, too much reporting within the team, and a lot of the meetings tend to be endless, and you seem to lose value out of collaboration then, right? So the point about all these interactions is really to create working software as soon as we can. We want to showcase the MVP as it is getting built frequently so that we get the feedback, collaborate with whoever is the customer proxy, voice of customer, and get the target, align with the target goal as early as we can, rather than bothering about contract negotiations and the stuff that you see in typical management approaches. So all of this boils down to this, that plans themselves are great, but planning is important. And that is where this manifesto item is, that more than following a set plan, try to respond to the change, because that is much more important to create something that somebody will buy. So I jump onto this slide here. There are 12 principles of iterative and incremental development that processes like Scrum and Crystal Extreme Programming. So these are the three processes that people created, and Scrum is the most popular of all. So all these three processes that I just mentioned align with 12 agile principles for iterative development and incremental development. So I'm taking two important principles and listing them here. One is immediate feedback. Immediate feedback from internal and external customers. That feedback loop is so important that in waterfall, we have these stage gates and the feedback loop comes very much late until you do FCS or maybe alpha before that, alpha beta before that. You don't really have customers seeing your product. Here you want to have customer with your room, in the room with the extreme programming team. Or if you are like Scrum team, every 2 or 3 weeks you have custom voice of customer, there is a role there called product owner, which represents that voice of customer, looking at the product being built and giving you feedback about that product. So you have some correction possibility there from that feedback before you really do product hardening later on when it comes to release and you deal with the external customer feedback there. So inspect and adapt is the second principle that I want to allude to here. And there are ceremonies such as release retrospectives or sprint retrospectives that that actually allow you to do. Very quickly, we are going to see a Scrum picture that many of you might have seen that shows this. I want to compare and contrast now with Lean. The background of Lean comes from Toyota Production System. When Toyota created Kanban in 1953, they really created something called Lean, which was based on just-in-time and waste reduction system. So there are 7 principles that that Mary Poppendike mapped the Lean manufacturing process to software development, and she came up with these 7 principles of Lean software development. The first is eliminating waste and rework, which means you constantly refactor your code. Don't do a mass refactoring of the code base that typically you see in waterfall team, that let's revisit our architecture, let's redesign this thing. Klaus, you must have gone through several of those waterfall hoops in your career so far. So the point about avoiding rework and waste creation is that we constantly refactor our architecture and code base, that we don't create a refactor as an event on or a milestone on some project plan. That's important thing. And it kind of ties into some of the agile principles. So you will very soon see that these seven principles that we are talking about map a lot with the five values of Agile Scrum and the 12 principles of Agile Scrum. So eliminating Western remark, amplifying learning, which is we learn something out of some failure, failing fast. We learn something out of failure. We are trying to apply that learning, and we grow that way. A lot of things from Lean are useful to Scrum. These two particularly are key. Decide as late as possible. We know that when we are under stress, we get back to our comfort zone and we make some rash decisions, and then those fail, and then we get into another waterfall, and then another rash decision comes up. A lot of time it comes from the as a result of pressure from above. But what you want to do as an architect or an experienced engineer or an experienced test lead is to decide as late as possible, which is to say you're deferring your commitment. You're still committed to completing this work, task in hand, but you're deferring your commitment by looking at all angles, doing some root cause analysis, and then going with a plan rather than being passive aggressive about it.
Can we skip the Lean part, because I don't think we'll be using it too much in the thing, and we have limited time for the team.
Sure. Absolutely. I just want to talk about these four things. So there's not much content here about this. So delivering as fast as possible, which means that you iterate. This maps a lot with Scrum. You iterate. You deliver as fast as you can, even though you're making decisions slightly late. You are still creating spikes of work and delivering as fast as you can. So empowering team, very important in Scrum process as well. Build integrity in, which is about being. Having integrity as a human being, that comes back to the respect value system of Scrum. Seeing the whole, this is an important part that is missing from Scrum process. Because Scrum process is iterative and incremental, a lot of times what happens is, and architects can see this very quickly, that a lot of times the big picture tends to be missing. A lot of times people want the whole pizza, not a slice of pizza. So you have to mix and match some of these when you start getting into execution mode. All right. Very quickly, Agile principles are all about iterative and incremental development, immediate feedback, inspect and adapt. Lean practices are all about eliminating rework, continuous improvement. So some of the success factors you see are listed here. Why people think about doing Agile and Lean? A lot of times there is time to market. A lot of times it is the quality issue that you face. An example for a lot of BUs here is time to market. An example from PayPal where I come from, there are customer satisfaction and quality that they decided to go for Agile Scrum there. So one of the quotable quotes from one engineer from CBVA BU, which is leading the Cisco's Agile Playbook or Escape Velocity program for a year now. So with Waterfall, you spend 12 months of planning with 4 months of engineering. With Agile, you're spending, within the Scrum planning context, 2 hours of planning for 54 hours of engineering. So that just tells you how much focus there is for productivity. You might have seen this slide. It's also called onion peeling slide, which is about the five levels of planning in Agile process. So the five levels of planning or feedback loops, so you have daily planning, you have that's the daily standard, and then you have, I don't want to get into the extreme programming part, I want to stick to the Scrum right now. So you have daily standard, and we'll come to that in a minute. So it's at a one-day level. There is acceptance testing that's at the sprint demo level. There is iteration planning, which is in terms of weeks. There's release planning, which is in terms of months. And there could be roadmap planning, which is the portfolio planning part of it, which is missing from this picture. So coming to Scrum, quick question, how many of you are familiar with Scrum process? Plus, little bit? Anybody over the phone?
Yes, a little bit, yeah.
All right, so I want to rush through this slide because there's some deep dive slides after this. So the process is all about inspect and adapt, that you do some work, create some MVP, and then inspect and adapt towards the target that that you set initially. So you're not just throwing, you're not just trying for a moonshot here. You're actually on the ground trying to iterate and do something. So the concept is very simple. You start with PM, the product manager, asking you for some kind of product plan, typically a portfolio backlog. So this is your list of features. It is now time to collaborate between marketing and engineering, and you come up with set of agreeable work items. We call it as product backlog. So this thing here, this file, is the product backlog. Now what happens is you look at the product backlog and create releases out of it, and now you have a large product backlog split into various release backlogs. You take the first release backlog and say, this release comprises of, let's say, 4 to 8 sprints, iterations, and we now take that backlog and slice it to the first sprint backlog. We take that sprint backlog, which is a set of stories, dash them out, and start sprinting. Teams meet on an everyday basis. They have a huddle of this kind. They have their daily scrum, as in rugby or American football. So they have that kind of huddle. They collaborate and at a peer-to-peer level discuss what they did yesterday. There are three questions: what they did yesterday, what they are doing today, and what are the obstacles. Experienced teams actually reduce those three questions to two questions. They start with, what is my obstacle and what I'm working on? If they are co-located, they know each other very well. They know what Ravi is working on, what Ravi did yesterday, and what Derek did yesterday. There's no need to talk about that. So that large Scrum teams, up to 10 to 12 people, can do a stand-up, especially in distributed Scrum of 8 to 10 people. You want to stick to two questions. What am I blocked, and what am I working today? You ought to know from each other what we did yesterday. I mean, there's no point in talking about it in a huddle like that. That is what high-performing teams do. Newbie teams start with those three questions. As you mature on the team dynamics curve, you get to that point where you reduce to two questions. You do that every 24 hours. It becomes a rhythm. And you eventually come to a point of demo to the product owner, which is your voice of customer. He or she looks at the work being produced, gives you feedback for some work that he or she may not accept. The good Scrum team has an acceptance percentage of 85% or more. A newbie team has 40 to 70%. A norming team on a team dynamics model would have 70 to 85% acceptance percent. What is acceptance percent? What product owner asks the team as sprint plan or sprint backlog, and what the team delivered to the comfort level of product owner. So that is a quick 2-minute introduction to Scrum. You will see lots of videos on YouTube about Scrum. You might have seen some of them. There are a lot of presentations of Scrum from within Cisco's community. but this is the fastest that I can introduce. Any questions on this? We trainers typically have an assumption. Silence means everybody understood. So there are some deep dives here. I kind of quickly went through this. So I made a note here about daily standards. You can see that Olle Model, one of the lean systems thinkers from Danberg, is one of the foremost XP coaches within Cisco. He came up with this idea that on his blog post, he wrote this once that ideally high-performing teams should start with obstacles and then come to what they did since last meeting and plan for the day in that order rather than what I did yesterday, what I'm planning to do today, and what is blocking me. So these are some of the best practices that I mentioned early on. All right. So I want to allude to this concept of extreme programming. The reason is Scrum by itself does not succeed. That has been my experience as a coach, that just using Scrum as an agile project management framework doesn't get you anywhere. The reason is, as an engineering company, you have to have engineering craftsmanship model. There is a another manifesto or a parallel organization. It's called Software Craftsmanship. It's like an alliance of a sort, just like Scrum Alliance. And the point about that group of engineers is that you can use Scrum, Kanban, Waterfall, it doesn't really matter. You have to be collaborating and using best practices. So I'm showing you some of the best practices, and the good part of extreme programming is that it aligns its as a process. It's not really a heavy-duty process framework like Waterfall framework or Waterfall process or Scrum process. It's really a set of practices. And the good part of this is that you choose what practices will work with you. You don't have to start with all 12 of them. You pick what works with you and then gradually take baby steps towards high performing. So the creator of XP practices, they created this diagram where, you know, it would be nice to start here, that think about simple designs, system metaphors. Start collaborating, pair programming. The current version of this practice is called mob programming, as if there's like crowd wisdom around programming, that you actually work as a mob, not just as a pair. So that one, and then test-driven development, that I would like to write my test case in Java using JUnit test framework. If I'm a Java developer, I would write not the main class, but the failing class, which is my test case object. And then that object, the methods in that object are going to fail because I've not written my main class yet. And so as I start writing the main class and its methods, my test object will start passing. So this is what is called test-driven development practice. There's a practice about refactoring. You refactor your code base every day. Don't consider refactoring as a milestone on a project plan, as in Waterfall. Some of the so-called scaled agile frameworks considered hardening as a sprint, and I don't agree with that approach at all. I like to refactor my code base every day rather than doing hardening towards the end. You may want to do it at a large program, yes, but as a team, I would like to refactor my code day in and day out. So as you can see, these practices actually build on top of each other, coding standards. Some of these you are familiar with even in your Waterfall days. If you have done stealth mode C programming or C++ programming in the 90s, you already know what I mean. Continuous integration is considered as another practice here. So one of the things here that is different than Scrum is that customer tests what you write. And there is also an assumption in XP practice or XP process that customer is with the whole team all the time, that customer is in the room. Scrum does not mandate that. XP does. So just a point there. But the good point about XP is that you can choose what practices are useful to your kind of team culture and then build on that. Use them for sure. Scrum just by itself does not take you anywhere. You ought to be doing some of this XP stuff as engineers. Any questions? Keep in mind that my slideware tends to be less in number but heavy in content. So I want to pause when I cover some content to give a chance to you to ask me questions. Plus, you're taking notes.
Yes. Well, a couple, to be honest.
All right. Thank you. Any questions?
No, well, okay. While you were talking about this, I was thinking that this is somewhat at odds with the way I learned how to do these things. I was taught to first think about the algorithm, come up with pre and post conditions, prove that your program is correct and stuff like that. And this is much more have a go at it and fail fast and then fix it. And I'm kind of wondering what method gives the least amount of bugs down the road.
No, so the program design, algorithm design doesn't go away. The practice of algorithm design or software engineering is not what this is about. This is more about when you're doing your algorithm design, you're validating the design on the fly. So if I were to come up with an algorithm, I would write the test object for that algorithm. And then it's like this. In the waterfall world, we wrote the algorithm class or set of classes, came up with the class design, looked at some dynamic models, came up with some sequence diagrams, some state machines, and implemented those, and then got with the code base. And then eventually we wrote the test harness. And that int main or CRV based approach, you know, writing the test after the fact, is more like how we did documentation in our schools.
Right.
And here you are actually looking at your test code as a way to document your code. Would you agree that you're kind of thinking about your algorithm and there may be some hard, heavy structural code there, even not necessarily purely object oriented, but maybe some structural code that you, from timing perspective, that you are writing. And the important thing is that as you write the method, you're actually writing the test up for that method in line so that testing is part of the development effort. That's really what that thing is.
You will
actually like a paradigm called behavior-driven development, which Dan North came in 2003, and that actually is something that I'm not having in this slide deck, but that is something that I covered with product managers just before release planning, if you recall, Derek. The point is that, or there, the point is that look at the behavior of the system under construction. And as an architect, you can very clearly look at it. Behavior is more part of the dynamic model of the architecture,
right.
The dynamic
right.
aspect of
okay.
the 4+1 architecture that you're looking at. And and then look at the scenario and use tools like EZB or JBehave or Cucumber, which are capable of reading those scenarios that are written in a particular construct. So, Christina, if you recall, we had a session with you about one of your features where we wrote some scenarios. And the point about, so that's another extreme programming practice, by the way, that that doesn't show up here. So the good part of XP is that the practices are still evolving, and it's not just this set of 12 practices that XP stands for. So architects, product managers, test leads, they love behavior-driven development, even more so than test-driven development, because you always, always want to look at the behavior of the system under construction. I had some static, and I just feel that that person wanted to ask some questions.
Were there other questions from folks on the call?
In the interest of time, I'm going to skip this slide.
Yeah, sounds good.
So we all understand that lean is all about eliminating or reducing waste. That's the gist of this.
And Kanban, we could probably skip also.
Yes, so I would rather skip this one. The point about Kanban is that you are looking at just-in-time system where upfront planning is not possible, and you're dealing with a lot of flux, a lot of unplanned work, then a flow-based system works better. I would like to talk about roles here. I have two slides, one for the manager role, and this is an important slide, and we might spend about 5 to 10 minutes on this slide. And I have a follow-up slide on team member, a similar slide. These two slides that I'm going to show are from Cisco-wide standard for agile roles and responsibility. There is a EDCS document. It is part of the Cisco's CPDM standard agile process documentation. So functional manager, there is a role shift here. Those of you who have been a people manager before or currently you have been a dev manager or engineering manager or test manager, you will realize that in Agile, you don't assign tasks to your engineers. Even though you have direct reports working on teams, Scrum teams, you want to be their mentors and coaches, and you are primarily responsible to unblock them, to take care of the obstacles. As managers, you have power as well as authority. That you want to use your power in the right way, that teams might be facing obstacles and you are their savior there. You are the one who are going to actually deal with those obstacles.
So in our CIS environment, what role would we be speaking about here?
So Josh, for example,
okay.
He is a functional manager, and he's a great functional manager.
Okay. So the delivery manager role in this case.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes, yes. So dev manager or tier manager fits in this role.
Okay.
And there are some don'ts here. There are some caveats that what you do not want to do when teams are scrumming is you do not want to decide what works needs to be done. That is done by the product owner for the team. You don't assign work to the team members. You don't keep track of what is happening with everyone on the team. Don't ask them for status reports. Trust the Scrum Master who is doing that for you, and help the Scrum Master unblock the obstacles. That is your primary role here. And also, grooming people, there's a lot of focus on people management here, that you want to develop your people, mentor them. So a couple of things that you don't want to do here is making commitments under pressure, giving dates to management. Those are the things that you did in waterfall days. You want to stand for the team and listen to the team, listen to the commitment that team is coming up with, and then tell the management that this is the current plan. These are not hard dates. that is very important for a functional manager to report out. And this applies to PMOs, by the way.
So yes. In the end, the functional manager has to come up with an evaluation of his team members, right? What is that based on?
Super question. So the point about going away from stack rank-based performance review in agile-based companies is proving that at least for those companies it is working. Classical examples that most coaches quote are companies like Netflix, PayPal to an extent, Spotify, but these are startups. In large companies, at HP, for example, and part of Symantec, I have noticed from coaches there that they are going away from the traditional performance review cycles. And that's a hard battle. That is an extremely hard battle.
We're having some emergency alerts on our cell phones.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Regarding the flooding around.
Yeah, looks like. Sorry about that. Moment. So going back to your question about performance reviews. Performance reviews in the new world tend to be a little different. And can I do this? We have to cover a lot of material here, and I can point you to some of experience reports that I have seen in the marketplace. eBay China implemented a 360 feedback mechanism in place of the standard eBay review practice that one ex-eBay product manager shared with me. He was eBay's champion in China, and in 2011 he implemented a 360 feedback. And the point of that was to have an assessment of a sort that the manager does a self-assessment, the team does a 360 feedback on the same kind of assessment, and then collectively they look at a heat map and they decide what the team needs to do, not an individual. An individual's contribution to the team is much more important in the Scrum process than the individual by himself or herself. That is the process of these kind of models. That's where I want to stop. Any other questions?
Sure.
And I'm going to share all these links towards the end. There are some really good coaches in the industry that have done work with Cisco as well. Pete Diemer has been Cisco Bangalore coach for a while now. He is known for Manager 2.0 article that he published on Scrum Alliance a few years back, and there is a link here. Jorgen Appello from Holland is known for Management 3.0 workouts, and he's got a toolkit that he talks about, and so that's another movement in the new style of management. So these are some of the things that I'm sharing. This table here talks about core responsibilities of manager in the new world of Agile. And if the teams are newbie teams, these are the additional responsibilities. And there is some training there that LDHG provides. So there's a training link here. When the teams move from newbie to practitioner status, there are some additional things that the manager wants, should do. And then eventually when the teams become innovator, they start contributing to the Agile Lean at Cisco community of, God knows, maybe 2,000 people or even more that used to attend those conferences that I was organizing for 3 years. At that level of maturity, manager actually does these things. So this is a framework that came out of some focal meetings that we have had as part of Central CDO group of coaches within Cisco's internal coaches network. Any questions? I know there's a lot of content here. So I want to pause for a minute.
This could be Josh and or Kuhn, actually.
Yes, right? Absolutely. And I have shared these decks with Kuhn and Josh.
Okay, good.
All right. I want to spend at least 10 minutes. Can you do a time check and also agenda check in terms of where do you think we are with respect to progress so far?
You went through the overview of the Scrum ceremonies. I don't know if you're going to do a deeper dive on those. I think it would be worthy to talk about the objectives of each of the ceremonies.
So we'll go back to the picture. You notice there were builds there.
Mm.
And so this is more like a multi-pass compiler now. So I'm doing breadth first, and then we'll go back to that slide. See, I'm a software engineer. I'm not a project manager. So you will see a lot of these kind of geeky words.
So basically, the first hour, which we're approaching the end of the first hour, was to cover the
overall
principles, the mm-hmm. team membership, which we're getting through now, and then you touched upon the ceremonies.
Yes.
The second hour would be more about the details around the data that we're storing.
Absolutely.
User stories, features, and such,
yes.
And then get into Rally.
Absolutely.
So if you could balance your time that way.
No, absolutely. So maybe this is the last slide that we cover here, back to the builds on that picture.
Okay, good. Talking about responsibilities of team members and Scrum Master here?
Just team member.
Okay.
So the important part for you to see here is that in Scrum teams, team members are actually throwing away their job titles, and they become specializing generalists. So I want to spend a minute or two on this definition of specializing generalists. What that means is, if I'm a middleware engineer and I'm used to writing connectors or what have you, I will continue to doing that, but I will also help the Struts developer or the Spring Webflow developer that is doing some backend development for UI for a bunch of JavaScripting engineers. So I'm throwing away my middleware engineer role for a moment for the team's success, such that even though I'm responsible for my middleware code, I'm helping the Webflow engineer, Spring Webflow engineer, or the Struts developer, or the Wicked API developer, or any such UI framework that you're using in your environment. So I'm going out of my comfort zone of middleware programming and helping out my team members wherever I can. Does that sound strange? Yeah, initially you will feel strangeness about this because you may not have done that before as a waterfall middleware engineer, but you realize that in a time box, when team takes on 5 to 10 stories to work on, it's all about the time box and the initial commitment, and it always helps to take one story at a time, work on it as a team, and then take the next, work on it as a team. But that's the nirvana state. That's the state that you will reach after maybe 6 months or 2 years. You would not know, right? So you at least start headway towards that. So this is called swarming. Might have heard this term, swarming. The point about this is swarm like bees. The point is that leave your job titles aside and work together. So some of the core responsibilities for the team member, you could be an architect, you could be a programmer, you could be a tester, you could be anybody on the team, let me put it this way. So core responsibilities is to create that working software. Remember the second manifesto item, working software or documentation. There's no point in creating mock objects based spikes and POCs anymore. Maybe initially, but not after that. You want to go out of that spiking phase and eventually develop software as much as possible, and develop by creating horizontal slices of the product, MVP, as well as vertical slices. They both are important. horizontal are important because Klaus, the architect there, would know that if there is no framework in object-oriented design or even structured design, there's not much possible because you will create spaghetti code base, right? So that's about horizontal slicing. Vertical slices are important because once you do that groundwork, ideally in iteration zero on a large program, you have a chance to now look at MVPs, slice that elephant, MVP being an elephant, slice that elephant into slices that you can deal with in a time box and work on those slices and implement them. So that's where you need to switch on from being specialist into specializing generalist. I'm not saying 100% generalist because that is like sense, and engineers cannot be sense because their managers don't expect that behavior. So as such, you want to start taking your baby steps towards farming. So once again, the same kind of pattern, there are some core responsibilities in terms of being able to concurrently design, develop, and create working product increment. Concurrently, why? Because you do not want to have a sprint for only architecture, the next sprint for only development, the sprint after that for only testing, and the fourth sprint being hardening. That is waterfall, sometimes called fast waterfall, and you'll see that happening in some Scrum teams, and you want to avoid that, which is why you want to concurrently design something, develop that design to validate that design in that time box, test it so that you validate the implementation, verify and validate that implementation, so that the product owner can get to see something that he specified early on. That's the value of doing all these three things concurrently. So one of the key things here is to decompose work into smart tasks. And I don't want to go into the theory of smart. You might have gone through some training before. HR generally covers this in multiple ways. I would really like to say that as a Scrum team, if you are talking about 3-week iteration, when I come to a sprint planning meeting, look at the stories, as a team member, I come up with tasks for a story that product owner wants in that Scrum team, Scrum sprint. I should typically task out story into tasks for myself such that the task finish in 2 or 3 days at most. So if 3 weeks would have at most 3-day tasks, you have 2-week sprints, there's no way you can have tasks that are like more than 2 days long, because you want to show something every day. It's pointless to have second day of stand-up coming in and Ravi is still saying that, and I'm still working on that task. And then the third day comes. Then you lose the value of the ceremony there, right? So you want to think about tasks that you can finish ideally in a few hours to a couple of days. And that kind of creates that discovery, collaboration, and such. One of the key ingredients for a successful Scrum team is focus on test automation. That's the fifth bullet here.
Yeah, and fortunately, we do have a dedicated QA person for our team.
Fantastic. And is the focus on writing JUnit tests and writing white box tests?
Trying to do some automation, yeah.
Fantastic. If time permits, I'm going to show some screenshots.
Unfortunately, our QA person isn't here, so we don't have to dive into that right now.
Sure. All right. So the important thing is that nobody is assigning you work as a team member. Since nobody is assigning me work, I actually take the ownership of the work and task it out and stand by it. And then if I'm stuck, I take help from my team members. I'm now collaborating. So that's the point. And once again, 3 levels of teams, right? Newbie teams, what is the additional stuff that I need to have? If I'm an architect, I should be available to the team. I know it's hard on Glass to be available in US time zone, but we can find some overlapping time and then figure out a way to collaborate. That's the best you can do, Glass.
Well, actually, it works sometimes to advantages as well. For instance, if we are dealing with Deutsche Telekom, it's convenient that I can be in their time zone. And I guess that's the type of thing you're talking about.
Absolutely, yes. Because now you're kind of voice of customer there in terms of ironing out some architectural feedback and what have you, right? The other thing that you want to eventually come to a full regression test cycle. Remember, in waterfall projects and product lines, it takes a lot of time to create the regression test phase. It's typically 4 to 6 months for a new product development until you see your first regression test run. Here, you want to think about it as early as possible. And that's the point that I was stressing out. Test automation is a key here. Once again, the XP practices can help you out there in terms of test-driven development or behavior-driven development. The point is about creating regression test suites enough in quantity and quality such that you can have some level of automated acceptance test possible so that the product owner actually, if he's tech or she is technical, can run some test suites, regression test suite, and accept some work that way. That would be the nirvana state. So the second stage is in practitioner mode, you actually start looking at the debt. There is no avoidance there that you will run into technical debt. No matter what level of software engineering expertise you have, you will always have some kind of technical debt. Tech debt can be managed if you do refactoring continuously, and that's where the practitioner level comes in, and you have to now have continuous integration, frequent code refactoring, and the best practices from XP that I was talking to about having test first or test driven unit test development, and even better behavior driven development. And what you're avoiding is that because of the tech debt pileup, you are delaying your MVP features and stories, and then QA gets even less time, and then you are running into defect debt now. So in addition to having tech debt, you have to now deal with SEV1, SEV2 defects in credits or what have you. I hope not CFDs, but something of that kind, perhaps. So thinking about automated acceptance test at this level of team maturity helps a lot. And then at innovator level, you want to have some kind of continuous delivery. Now we have these monthly release cycles. In continuous delivery mode, you actually have hot feature deploys, and those are disabled until the full automated test happens on the production for a feature that is currently being deployed but disabled. That is how Netflix works. That is how PayPal works. That is how I want WebEx and CIS and parts of this company that is SaaS-based should work. Klaus, would you agree? There is a company that Cisco acquired in September 2011. Need to stress this point here. The company was developing a Microsoft client code base, continuous delivery based code base, and they integrated with WebEx. The CEO of that company, founder from MIT grad from that company, founder, Ben Renaud is one of the CD experts within this company, and he's part of the internal coaches network that I co-founded a few years back. So anytime you have questions on continuous delivery, you would ask Ben Renaud or his chief architect, Patrick, forgot his last name. But there are a lot of experts within the company. I see that SDLC team has some expertise in the Go tool, and I think that's a good transition plan to have. To move from continuous integration to continuous delivery is extremely hard for the company. I would request you all to make use of resources available. But that's the innovator phase. That's when you really are high-performing Scrum team. That you don't no longer need traditional waterfall-style release management governance model. Fair enough? I covered a lot of stuff. And this can be heavy. I want to pause again for a couple of minutes. You guys watch this slide and fire questions if you have. Klaus is the only one so far asking questions. I want some more participation. I get bored. I am a coach, not so much a teacher or trainer. I like to have interaction.
Yeah, Christina and her team are working under Agile Scrum, so they're pretty familiar with these concepts.
Perfect. Fantastic. All right. So I want to skip the process training and go back to my slide. Give me a minute. I want to cover the ceremonies part of the slide deck.
Yeah. And then once we cover the ceremonies, we can touch upon the hierarchy of information that we're storing around features, user stories, and tasks.
Yes, yes. So I talked briefly about this. So perhaps I would take this opportunity to do a deep dive as a second pass compiler design.
I think you did a good job covering the daily Scrum. Maybe
yes.
We can talk about sprint planning and sprint demos.
Absolutely. So let's look at it. So we understand that the team's voice of customer, who is the product owner, I did not have that particular slide from the roles and responsibilities standard. I had the team member slide. I had the functional manager slide. But I think I should include the Scrum Master and Product Owner tabular slides as well.
That's okay.
That would be something that I could do in future.
Yeah.
But anyway, the Product Owner, who is the voice of customer, he comes into the team with prioritized features. Now, that's your
he or she, Christina,
he or she.
Christina.
Yeah. Sorry, Christina. He or she. Now, that's your portfolio backlog in a sense that it's your feature backlog. How many of you think backlog as a derogatory term? Please don't do that if you are thinking that way.
Yeah, that's the initial sense that I had.
No. So you do not want to. It's like, yeah, this is the work. This is my to-do list.
Mm-hmm.
Look at it more like.
Yeah, it's like something that you kind of sweep to the side.
That's not how you look at it.
I know.
Yeah,
but that's
very important. I think that's something that is a very, very implicit
mm-hmm.
reaction.
Yes.
When you hear this term backlog,
yes.
You react like that, right? It is not that. The backlog is really...
It's your inventory of work to do.
That's right. I look at it as an array list. Architect would understand what I mean, or engineers would as well, right? That this is a list of items. The first items on the stack, this is like a data structure, like a stack. The top items there are the low-hanging fruits, the work that I already know enough about. The bottom of this stack is the epics, the stuff that I don't have to bother about right away. And it is the responsibility of the product owner to move those items that are at the bottom of the backlog, refine them, and then move it up the stack to make them more succinct, more clearer, that the team will have less questions about. So that's the point about backlog. Think of it as a stack. Fair enough? Now you take the initial items from the top of the stack, call it sprint backlog, get into a sprint planning meeting. Purpose of this sprint planning meeting is to review the backlog that you have, that you have chosen for the sprint. The term used is sprint backlog here. You estimate that. Now, you do not estimate this in the waterfall style of, you know, how many man days or any of that. You don't do that. If you have been here at the release planning event, you'll know what I mean. Remember, we had this sizing board where people in the team actually looked at the features that Christina specified, and they sized that work and then created some kind of user story decomposition, took the stories and put it on a sizing board. The sizing board had story points listed as Fibonacci numbers. 1 point, column for it. 2 point, a column adjacent to it. 3 point story, a column next to it. 5 point story, the fourth column. 8 point, and 13 point. And then finally, 20 and above, meaning huge stuff that we don't have any clue about, right? So you look at the feature decomposition, you start putting stories on that kind of sizing board. That is the modern style of agile estimation. During this kind of planning meeting, teams actually do what we call as planning poker. The purpose of that is it's like deck of cards, or even fingers can be used. And product owner says, this is the story I want you to deliver in the sprint. And the team starts estimating that work. Klaus would, like every other team member, at once show up their numbers or show up their cards. You're using the planning poker cards, show up their cards. Klaus might say 3 points, sorry. Derek might say 5 points. Ravi might say 8 points. In a planning poker estimation part of this particular planning meeting, sprint planning meeting, what you then want to do as Scrum Master, as well as architect, as well as engineer, is to look at the outliers, look at the boundary conditions, edge cases. Why did Ravi think that this was 8 points or 13 points? Or why did Derek think this was a 1 pointer or 2 pointer, where rest of the team is settling on maybe 3 or 5 points? You see what I mean? You have that conversation, rule out some risks, rule out some complexities that way, and then you have a solid estimate. Now, this estimate is relative estimate, guys. We human beings, we engineers, can never estimate. In software engineering, it is proven beyond doubt that we cannot estimate level of effort ever. However number of years we might have spent in programming and software engineering, we cannot do that upfront. The best way we can do that is this is twice larger than this, or maybe this is 4 times bigger than this. That's about it. You can do relative estimates much more accurately. That's the point behind the agile estimation using planning poker practice, a practice that came from extreme programming, by the way. You can see how Scrum and XP mingle. So anyway, you do that, and then eventually you commit to the sprint time box. Some of the advanced Scrum teams within Cisco use Scrum boards. They use team rooms with dedicated walls, and you would have physical Scrum boards, and using telepresence rooms like these, TP devices like this. They call it sections within Danberg terminology. You would have a TP Scrum room here in San Jose, another in Bangalore and such, and they can use it. If you use Rally, you use a storyboard in Rally. So towards the end of this session, we will also cover what and hows of Rally, and what do we do in sprint planning team as a team member? Right. What should I be doing?
Right. That, as an input for sprint planning, you also need to know your capacity, your velocity.
Right? That's very important. And where do you get that? You do not use this technique of 1 point equal to 1 person per day. That is ridiculous. What you want to do is go by this relative sizing board and say that, you know what, historically, these kind of stories that we did in past were 1 point stories. And this other kind of stories look like they're 3 point stories. See what I mean? You have to create that frame of reference based on your empirical experience. Use that, find your empirical velocity trend, and say that on a trend line, on a velocity histogram, we have been trending around, 45 points? So therefore, we can take 45 points. If you run into an engineering manager that says you should do twice, as a Scrum Master and product owner, you have to protect your team. Architect, you play important role there too, that you want to dodge those bullets. Keep that in mind, that you are together in this and that you want to deal with those obstacles.
Right.
I consider that as an obstacle.
Right. It's the self-managing team that has the best understanding of what capacity they can handle.
Exactly.
During a sprint time frame.
Team knows the best what capacity it can deal with. So that's important. You must input some capacity and then try to come up with a commitment that is close enough. Now, like I said early on, as a newbie team, you will see some failures. That's okay to fail. It's okay to fail. You have to somehow have your scrum master coach the management that in first few sprints, it's going to be hard journey.
Right. An experienced team will know how much they can handle in a given time frame, but a new team needs to establish that.
Exactly. And that's why you will have first couple of failures that, yeah, we started with 45 and we barely did 30.
Yeah.
That's okay.
Yeah.
It's a learning experience. There may be some special cost. You have to look at some kind of RCA, doing some RCA, understanding what happened there. But that's not the point. The point is being empirical about this. Using your past experience. This is more like statistical process control now,
right?
That you're looking at your empirical data and using it to plan.
Right. And a lot of these things will come to light in the sprint demonstration as
yes.
well as the retrospective, right?
Absolutely. So
is
a critical part,
indicated?
No, we'll cover stuff
okay.
like that.
Okay.
So once you establish your sprint goal, that maybe you will have a theme for a sprint or a goal for a sprint, that you know what, in this sprint, we'll deal with SSO. The next sprint, maybe we'll deal with some tool integration. You see what I mean? You come up with sprint goals, and you try to create stories around that sprint goals. So this way, you're creating MVP much faster. So that's the point about this planning meeting. The important thing is to be true to yourself, realistic, look at your capacity, and your time off. Very important to let everybody know that I'm off on those 2 days, and then come up with a team calendar and say that this is the level of effort possible out of this kind of capacity and try to swarm on that work now. Extremely good teams take one story at a time, swarm on it, take the next. That's the Kanban style of just in time. Stop starting, start finishing mindset. Newbie teams will do development in the first week, testing in the next week. That is called fast waterfall. If one coach or anybody comes to you and say that you are not doing Scrum the right way, ask him to get out of there. Just understand that you are self-organizing team and you will do something like that. That's not considered failure in my books. That is a learning process. You will do that mistake. But the point is that you want to learn that. That was a mistake. That's the realization that you want to have there. Let's look at some other bills as they come. So I'm looking at this part here, the rightmost part now. Do you have your daily standards, auto-correction mode or self-correction mode every day, meet for 15 minutes, correct yourself, your progress. If you are going on a tangent, refocus that, you know what, that's not what we really wanted to develop. Get back to the base, main line. You have to come up with best practices, friends. You have to think about branching, merging strategies, sequence merges, dealing with merge conflicts. You have to actually be on the dot with respect to your sprint goal. Now, what you want to do, initially you will see that you will have burn down. There is a term called burn down chart here. That is your reporting. The team's reporting is really burn down charts. In team rooms here at Cisco, you will see teams having their scrum boards, storyboards, and burn down charts visible to the whole world. Whoever wants to see it, it's open, you can see it. You don't have to ask the scrum master or architect or the product owner where we are and give me a PowerPoint deck. What you want to coach your management and PMO and engineering managers and QA managers and anybody above is to look at team burn downs in Rally and see that tells you right in your face how the team is doing. How is the work burning down? That's really the point there, that we started with 45 points. On the second day, we accepted maybe 3 points. If you're high-performing teams, the product owner starts accepting work as soon as it is completed. Newbie teams, you will see a pattern that because of the fact that in the first week you're doing development, in the second week it comes to Ravi for testing, you will have the product owner, of course, accepting the work on the last day of
the very end, yeah.
And that is considered a hockey stick burn down, that it's not really burning for first few days, it's burning down on the last day. It's called hockey stick burn down. But that's okay. It's a learning experience, right? Eventually, you will see some smooth trend line. But that's the point, that you demo the software that you have developed, and then you retrospect. That is very important. Do not skip retrospective. Maybe in the initial sprints, you will see that under pressure from managers that you're reporting to, or in general, maybe that's how you worked in the past, you will not have time for retrospective because maybe you're not done yet. So in the first few sprints, you will see that you have ditched retrospective. And that's okay. Once again, the process framework is a framework. It's okay to ditch any of these ceremonies, but realize that you are bypassing the principles and the practices that high-performing teams would do. Realizing that we are newbie and we didn't really have time to do that 30-minute retrospective meeting, we bypass it. Next time you learn from it and do that meeting. The point about that meeting is to use... You want to do anything and everything to promote good habits. That you want to retrospect and learn from some of the points that team came up with. Some of the coaching moments here that I want to utilize. In retrospective, is it okay to involve product owner? Of course, yes. Product owner is considered pig. Pig meaning the worker bee, meaning the generalist in the team. Whereas a functional manager or any other, you want to try to avoid them attending that meeting. Because of the direct influence and reporting structures, there will be times that the confidentiality agenda of that meeting will be compromised. When you have managers in the meeting like that, you will have no openness. So you want to be very open about things. Techniques that I have used in the past, techniques like speedboat games. Imagine the team was like a boat and the boat is slowing down. You want to know what are the anchors, who are the sharks, what are the rocks, where is the beach. Using metaphors like that, you want to see the positive energy, the negative energy, what are the anchors that we want to tackle. There are several ways to conduct it, retrospective. Another common technique is called event line, which is people remember events, timeline. And you know what, on the second day of the sprint, something happened. My car got hit, or I was into something, or I was pulled into some unplanned task by my manager. Whatever it is, create a timeline and try to discuss it that way. It doesn't have to be what went well, what went wrong, and what can we improve, and now decide the top three action items out of these improvement backlog. That is the traditional way to conduct retrospective. Do not use one way. Make that meeting exciting. Look at blog posts by coaches like myself and what have you. There are fantastic practices for conducting retrospectives. That's one open practice in Scrum that you eventually want to come up with a retrospective action board, which is like a board of to-do, assigned, and what's the status. The last thing you want to do out of Scrum retrospective is to repeat that action item again next time. That is one reason why, as a coach, I have noticed teams start going away from that meeting. As a team, you want to watch out for that you want to take the actions on the action items that came out of retrospective immediately in the next week or two, so that we don't repeat those situations, unless those are organizational dysfunctions and stuff like that.
Great. I think that was a great coverage of the ceremonies.
Perfect.
So let's talk about the hierarchy of information.
Absolutely. So let's see how, what's the best way to do that. Let me go to Rally here. I'm going to share this URL.
And we have 30 minutes left, Ravi.
Absolutely.
To cover that as well as fundamentals of Rally, if possible.
Yeah. So what I'm doing now is I'm sharing this URL with everybody, and then I move to Rally right away. Right. I shared the link with everyone. Did you get the link?
No, we haven't got that yet. Probably just send it to some individual.
Okay, just a minute. Let me stop sharing. And where is the link? Where do I?
You want to just chat it to us?
Yeah. Okay. I want to send the chat link. So share. Is that share?
No, you can just. There should be a chat.
I don't see the chat panel here. Do you see the chat panel? Oh, here. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Sorry. So, yeah, I shared with everybody.
Okay.
Nice.
Yes. Yes, indeed.
Okay, perfect. All right. So, I want to pull up
Actually, you did it just to me.
Oh. Yeah, it's only to Derek Club. It's not everyone.
Yeah, to everyone.
Okay, I'll send it to everybody. Sorry about that. All right. So, this is one link that I want to share.
There you go.
Now, what I also want to share is another link that is contributed by several coaches in Cisco community. And this page is a page for you to learn at your pace about the hierarchical information capture in Agile Scrum. So this is about how you actually create user stories and the hierarchy of information. There's one picture from that page that I want to look at for all of us before we jump on to Rally. So let me open up that picture. Yeah, just a minute. Let me log into Rally so that I have that screen open. And I will have the team selected. Give me a minute here. I'm going to share once again. All right. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Perfect. What I'm covering here is something that we did for about 2 weeks before the release planning event in November. I'm showing something about requirements gathering. And I'm showing an example from Rally here. So the example is about an epic level work that one team called Videoscape product line team did within SPVTG when I was coaching them 3 years back, 2 years back. So this is an epic story. This is a high level story about provisioning MPEG-2 assets, digital assets, video file format, MPEG-2, if you know what I mean by that. And this is a provisioning EPIC whereby you want to provision these digital assets, MPEG-2 assets, and control that whole provisioning as an administrator on the set-top box for Verizon. That was the end customer. So, as you can see, the requirement is written. As an external system, this is the actor for this EPIC, I want to provision the video resources and services and control those resources, the digital assets, so that this whole provisioning and control process can be automated. This is what product manager wanted. So the technical lead, technical leader wrote this epic for him and for that product manager. And so instead of writing the acceptance criteria in English language, we chose to write them using this technique. This is what is called behavior-driven development technique. So you would see that there are various aspects of this particular epic. So there are various scenarios involved. One scenario is about provisioning the impact to digital asset resource. The other scenario is about starting to capture the resource. And the third scenario is stopping that capturing process. There are multiple use case scenarios, if you want to use that term, use case scenarios here. I'm not offended as Agile coach at all. I'm not hung upon semantics. Work is work. So you call it feature, you call it epic, parent story, user story, whatever it is. I write it this way, and then I write acceptance criteria in form of scenarios. The beauty of this approach is that these scenarios are not always coming from product management or the technical leader who is writing this stuff up. The QA lead or the architect on the team can contribute based on his or her experience. Remember, a lot of us are long tenure engineers and architects and leads on the teams. We should bring our experience on the product line and add to the and contribute to the story writing process. Once you write these acceptance criteria like this, scenario-based acceptance criteria, what can happen is something like this, that you can pull up your Eclipse GUI. I have a picture here from a training video, a 10-minute training video on behavior-driven development. You can create test suites. If you're a Java developer, you can plug in EZB framework and create behavior-driven development scenarios and start writing code like, you know, before. So given this context, when this happens, given this context, when this happens in the scenario, then this is the outcome. See what I mean? Hard to read? Better? I have a very high resolution LCD panel here. Maybe that's. Can you see it better now?
Yeah.
Perfect. So the point about this technique is that you create executable specification. That's the whole point here, that that you actually not only write the user story, but you write the acceptance criteria for that user story. Now at this level, it may be a feature, it may be a high level story, I don't know yet. Maybe it is a leaf node story, I don't know yet. This is what I call as inside out product management, that you actually focus on the work, look at the scenarios involved in the work, and then break that work down based on the scenarios and write the scenarios and think of what is the story that is evolving now. So this is the organic way of writing user stories. The traditional way, hierarchical way of writing user stories is to think about portfolio management. What is the portfolio of work involved? What are the features that we want to commit to in next quarter or 6 months on the roadmap? And then for each feature, you do the decomposition, similar to what we did in release planning. That is the traditional top-down way. The organic way is this kind of way, which many engineers understand intuitively, that you are always working on scenarios and you kind of work through the scenarios and create hierarchy organically that way.
Yeah, this is nice, very good example.
Absolutely.
How about the concept of definition of done versus acceptance criteria?
Absolutely. On this page itself, I have some examples and I want to go there. Fantastic segue to that. And the point about definition of done is that you want to guide your product owner to use some form of checklist to indicate when work is done. And the checklist, depending on your team, need not come from top from PMO to the teams. No, need not be a mandate. That's what I meant. It can come from, again, team level definition of done. From team to team, you may have different contexts, different team charter, and based on your team charter, you come up with your definition of done. The items in that kind of definition of done are items like when you accept the story, we recommend that these are some of the common things that you see. If you're accepting parent story, then make sure that all the child stories are done. And they, when you mean by done, they, these parameters are the checklist items are applied to them too. What you want to confirm is basic stuff. If you are a development team, then your code complete and code check-in is not causing build breakage and any of that that stuff. That you have test coverage, and it need not be 100% if that is not technically possible in your domain. So you come up with your percent coverage that you want to achieve and try to stand by that. If you involve a code base that requires C++ type of code or C type of code, then you might want to have no warning in terms of static analysis. If you have UX, and I know that your teams have UX, then whatever your UX designer has come up with, then the UX review is complete on that story. That, you know what, I wanted that submit button here or that create content button here, and you actually have a HTML link instead of a button. You see what I mean? You don't want those last minute things. And then acceptance criteria on the story. Those BDD style acceptance criteria that you would have written, you want them to have passed. That you have a lot of acceptance test coverage and that you have those tests passing in your test bed. If Bernie comes after you in terms of documentation, you want to at least hit some high-level documentation. If at least at the JavaDocs level that you have some REST APIs documented, that is a good start, I would say. And then if you have a overall regression test suite that you are sustainably maintaining, then you want to contribute to that with your new code base. That's another thing that you might want to have. This is something that you might have to come up with an exception clause. So you have to, as a team, define what are your quality goals for the kind of work that you do, and say we should be within 70% of quality goals or 80% of quality goals. It might mean that becoming a little smart about the quality goals, things like per sprint, we can have at most one, save three issue, something of that kind. Be a little bit quantitative, that way management loves it because they like quantitative stuff, and that way your definition of done becomes easier to implement.
But I think these are things that Christina and I can take a stab at.
Yes, and come up with them.
And then work with the team on it.
I also want you guys to think about, we have 15 more minutes. Yeah. I want to cover Rally too.
Mm-hmm.
I want you guys to think about definition of ready. This is important. This actually will take you to the lean Kanban style of pulling stories. So as product owner, let's say Christina comes up with stories. And now definition of ready means in sprint planning, we will pull this story only if it meets this criteria. And you can come up with your criteria set. Once again, this is a recommendation.
It just really puts the accountability on the product owner, right?
Yes.
To fully define.
Yes, absolutely.
User story.
So that the user story is defined, the acceptance criteria are defined, the story is sized, dependencies are identified and ironed out. We have accepted the UE artifacts that yes, this is the kind of UE we want here, user experience. We have identified the performance criteria or constraints, depending on where you are on your performance tuning.
Yeah, I think you have to be a really high-performing team to
come up with something like that and adhere to that.
Real ideal world.
Yeah, I agree. So at this point, I want to spend next few minutes to show what Rally looks like. So let's spend some time there. shout at me if you haven't used Rally. Say your name. I want to know how many here know Rally.
No Rally or don't?
If you had asked the question 3 days ago, I would have said aye, but...
All right. He's a veteran. So,
Klaus, you're a veteran now. All right.
Exactly. No secrets for me.
All right. So let's select our team quickly. Which is the team? Tell me.
Identity management.
Yes. This one?
Yep. It's down on this.
All right. I want to quickly show you a few things. First, I want to show what the current hierarchy looks like. In Rally, there is this portfolio menu option, and you select the hierarchy view. Now, this can show you the top-down hierarchy that Derek alluded to early on, which is select a particular feature. Do you want to select any particular feature that we are working on this particular sprint? That is got a nice drill down here. I see that there are some, 7 features that we can look at some deep dive.
Christian, you want to choose one?
Any choice, Krishna, you have?
For what it looks call. Like right now.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
No preference.
All right. So let's look at the...
They're pretty empty, by the way, though. They didn't completely fill them out yet.
I just want to use this opportunity to look at some of the requirements. So let's look at this one. Global IDM architecture. So I click here, I see some stories. Looks like these 3 stories are tasked out because if I click them, I'll see list of tasks. So this is the kind of hierarchy that I was talking about in Rally. You go to portfolio menu option and look at hierarchy view. It will show you what is the percentage complete on that feature and what's happening with the story. What is important to know that when you get into sprint planning, let us say I am one of the team members and I'm contributing to this story. During sprint planning, once we size the story and we say it is 8-point story here, like it says here, I need to task out. I need to put my tasks. So I go to this screen here and then start adding tasks. So, to see if I can find the action. Yeah, here, you can see new tasks. Or if both of these tasks are mine, I can do a multi-edit and edit them. So this is the kind of thing that you want to do during sprint planning meeting. Once you have sized all the work for the sprint, you actually come here, task out. And it's important to do this in first couple of days. Reason is when you go to tracking during your daily standups, you'll be using track iteration status menu option. And over here, I don't know how to minimize this. Is there a way to minimize this? Here? How to minimize this?
There's an X.
I don't see it here.
Okay, maybe just move it out of the way then.
I don't seem to drag that.
I can move it around.
All right. So I will try my level best to move my cursor. I'll look at your screen and do it. Oh, you move it for me. That way I can see at your screen and try to do it. Okay.
Okay. While you're looking at that, I have a hard stop in 10 minutes.
I want to quickly show something. Okay. I want to quickly show a burn down chart. And if you move it a little bit to the left, that's it. So I want to click on the chart here and open that chart. I wish I could do that. Can I pass the ball to you instead and you show it to the team?
Sure.
Yeah. Let's do it.
My process froze.
All right. So in any case, this actually user interface shows you the burn down chart. And that is what I wanted to show. So I'll stop sharing at this point and then have Derek try to load this in his browser. see if we can show it to you guys in the next few minutes. But as a team, it is important to know that as a team member during sprint planning meeting, I need to task out as early as I can for the work that I'm committing to, such that I can stand by it and that the burn down will look smoother and not like a hockey stick.
Can you try and task properly?
Yes, I stopped sharing already.
Okay. I don't have much control for some reason.
Okay, I can make you the... Yes, you're the...
Okay.
All right, you can share now. Yeah, can you see his screen?
Yeah.
Perfect. So now if you select the track iteration status menu option, you can see the burn down. Yeah, open that. Yeah. So in this view, you can see that you started on 3rd, you tasked out on 8th, and then the first 3 days, 8, 9, 10, 11th, not much things happened. And maybe now you may be actually completing the tasks. So it's 11th today, and it is showing that we have what, if you mouse over here, we have 48 story points to do. And we haven't really accepted anything. You will see that in initial few sprints, you will have product owner accepting work here, and you'll see a lot of green bars on this histogram, but that's okay. As you become much more mature team, you will start seeing that you will do the demos much more frequently and as many as you can. During stand-up, you can say that I've completed this, can apply the definition of done and accept the story, Miss Product Owner.
Right.
So that's about it.
Okay.
It's also useful to look at the same data from cumulative perspective. Now, this is the lean perspective where you look at the daily snapshot in a cumulative manner and see where is the fat belly, where is the work in progress. You might see that we are defining a lot of stuff here. That's where the fat belly is today. But as you go on in this release 3, a couple of sprints down, you will notice that perhaps you are actually spending more time in progress state. Or maybe you are completing a lot and Christina gets busy for whatever reasons and she's not accepting, so the fat belly is now in completed section. So you can see that this fat belly or this, the concept of total WIP from Lean can be applied to Scrum teams also. That we are looking at cumulative flow diagram for these 2 weeks and trying to look at where is the work in progress happening, in what state it is. So I would request you to look at both of these all the time. And that's about it.
Yeah.
Now all of you are Rally practitioners. I've stamped you. I was subscription admin for 3 years at Cisco and 2 years at PayPal, workspace admin. So I've been workspace admin here for CCS.
Yeah, so all the concepts that you spoke of about defining our user stories, documenting the narrative and
yes.
acceptance criteria, we can now start doing that.
Absolutely.
And as you said, as we go through daily sprints, hopefully we can start looking at work that's been done
yes.
and accept things as we go along in the sprint cycle.
No, absolutely. So one thing that you want to start doing as best practice, as early as you can, is please, please, please start defining acceptance criteria, not in English language, but in that template that I was showing, because that's very important. That's important because that is what developer will program his code towards. That is what architect will design for, and that's very important.
And that's what QA will follow.
Absolutely. Those scenarios is what you're going to validate against your architecture, against your implementation, and any automated acceptance tests written in Ruby, Perl, Python, whatever it is, Cucumber, JBehave, EZB, your call.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Pascal.
Hey guys. Any questions? Pascal is a
lovely. Pascal, not basic, COBOL. I started.
No. I learned programming in Pascal and still do that.
Yeah.
I just
change the syntax a bit.
I love it. For data structure, teaching and learning, nothing beats Pascal. All right. Any questions from the audience?
I'm laughing, but
are you going to send out the slides
today, Rafi?
Yes. I'm going to share the slides. They're also available on the link that I showed early on the wiki page for the Agile team
members.
I was sharing.
Yep.
So there are a lot of items there that I want you to go through. That page actually takes on from here, and there are a few things about software development that I want you to look at. It's more towards extreme programming and things of tactical nature, such as Cisco-wide continuous integration job aid that I created back then, and it has levels of CI maturity, and at what level of maturity, what do you do? And there are some example screenshots from Eclipse GUI, Rally integration, Maven, Hudson Jenkins integration, and all that good stuff that you engineers will love to see from the SDLC team, hopefully, in coming months or weeks. All right. Thank you. Thank you all for your time.
Any other questions,
thank
guys?
Thank you very much, Rafi. It was very useful.
Yeah.
Thanks, Rafi.
Thank you, sir.
Yep, we're in recording mode, so I'll pass it on.
Perfect.
We'll
thank
talk
you.
To you guys later.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye,
guys.
Bye.
Bye, then.